Where is the wrath of the oppressor? The cowering prisoners will soon be set free. They will not die in their dungeon, nor will they lack bread. For I am the Lord, your God, who stirs up the sea so that its waves roar. The Lord Almighty is his name. I have put my words on your mouth and covered you with the shadow of my hand. I who set the heavens in place, who laid the foundations of the earth, and who say to Zion, you are my people. The epistle in Colossians 1, 9 through 14. For this reason, since the day we heard about you, we have not stopped praying for you. We continually ask God to fill you with the knowledge and his will through all his wisdom and understanding that the Spirit gives, so that you may live in a life worthy of the Lord and please him in every way, bearing fruit in good work, growing in the knowledge of God, being strengthened with all your power according to his glorious might, so that you may have great endurance and impatience, and giving joyful thanks to the Father who has qualified you to share in the inheritance of his holy people in the kingdom of light. For he has rescued us from the dominion of darkness and brought us to the kingdom of the Son who loves, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. So ends the lessons.
Let us confess together our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Call the children forward for the children's message this morning. Now I'm going to need some helpers here this morning, so if you gentlemen would go up there to the podium. Thank you. I have a verse from the Bible that kind of fits. My heart here. And that verse in the Bible is found in the Proverbs. And this is what it says about our heart. Watch over your heart with all diligence. What does that mean, diligence? Well, that means really being careful. Really being very, very specific. Watch over your heart with all diligence. From it flow the springs of life. Well, do you know that I can look inside my heart this morning? And our heart? Got a little window here. What do you know? What do you know? What do you think we see inside? What do we see inside that heart? Loud, Dorothy. Swear bad words. Do we have bad words in our heart? I think sometimes we do. What does the first or second commandment say, Caleb? Are you giving the commandment?
Do
over by the mic there.
The first or the second?
Second. Thou shalt not take the name.
Thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, for he does not hold him guiltless who taketh the name in vain.
Okay. When he gave that commandment, what's that saying? Thou shalt not do what? Take the name of the Lord in vain. What does that mean, do you think? Takes it in vain. Well, let's hear what the meaning to the commandment is.
We should fear and love God so that we do not curse, swear, conjure, lie, or deceive in his name, but call upon him in time of need and worship him with prayer, praise, and thanksgiving.
So what do we need to do about this business, about this these bad words that are in our heart? We need to have Jesus forgive us, right? And I forgot to bring my white out over. I was going to take and white it out. But he does that. It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse these words out of our hearts. All right? Good. You got it? I got it too. I love telling it. Thank you for helping, gentlemen. And thank you and Lord bless you for the service now. And go out and have good, clean hearts. Right? Good. Thank you. That goes for all of us. Right? Let's sing in preparation for the message. God will take care of you. 5-6-4. 5-6-4.
God will take
gospel text for this morning, this 24th Sunday after Trinity, is found in Matthew, the gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 9. We'll be reading verses 18 through 26 for the reading of the word. Shall we stand in respect for God's word? You are able. Matthew 18, 9 through 18 through 26. While he was saying these things to them, behold, there came a synagogue official and bowed down before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come lay your hand on her and she will live." And Jesus rose and began to follow him, and so did his disciples. And behold, a woman who had been suffering from a hemorrhage for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak. For she was saying to herself, "If I only touch his garment, I shall get well." But Jesus, turning and seeing her, said, "Daughter, take courage. Your faith has made you well." And at once the woman was made well. And when Jesus came into the official's house and saw the flute players and the crowd in noisy disorder, he began to say, "Depart. The girl has not died, but is asleep." And they began laughing at him. But when the crowd had been put out, he entered and took her by the hand, and the girl arose. And this news spread out into all that land. These are thy words, Heavenly Father. Sanctify us and guide us in the truth, for thy word is truth. Amen. You may be seated. There are a lot of situations for a lot of people where there is hopelessness, an impossible situation. There were three individuals in these verses this morning where they were faced with a hopeless situation, or were really themselves filled with hopelessness. The first of the three was the ruler. Now, I think it's important to understand that this man was a man of local importance and of some high esteem and position. From Mark, the chapter 5, verses 22, and then from Luke, chapter 7, verse 41, we learn that his name was Jairus. And his particular importance was that he was the ruler of the local synagogue. Now, Barclay, in his commentary, gives an excellent explanation to help us appreciate the hopelessness of this man's situation. First of all, the ruler of the synagogue was a very, very important person. He was elected from the elders of the church, so he had the confidence and esteem of his fellow elders. He had the care of the external order of public worship and the supervision of the concerns of the synagogue in general. He appointed those who were to read and to pray in the service and invited those who were to preach. It was his duty to see that nothing unfitting took place, and note that, that's an important statement, I believe, to understand the whole circumstance. It was his duty to see that nothing unfitting took place within the synagogue, and the care of the synagogue buildings was in his oversight. The whole practical administration of the synagogue was in his hands. Then he goes on to explain, that is, Barclay goes on to explain, he would not be one of those strictly he would be one of those strictly Orthodox Jews who regarded Jesus as a dangerous heretic. So we see the position of Jairus, and we see there Jesus out teaching his teachings, which Jairus thought was really heresy. Now, a problem developed at home. And not unlike would be for any one of us. Jairus' daughter fell ill. He took the necessary precautions of that day to try to find a cure for his daughter. But as time progressed, she continued to worsen. And then there, apparently present, watched his daughter fade until she breathed her last breath. Death and hopelessness. There was shock. There was anguish. There was desperation. I've heard it so many times said by parents who've lost a child. You know, we know that we face the loss of a spouse, but when there's the death of a child, it just was not expected. It's so painful. And certainly that was the case for Jairus that day. And out of this shock and this terrible death in the family of this daughter, somehow, well, we don't know, but somehow the name Jesus came to him, and it didn't make any difference to Jairus what his teaching was at the time, but he went to Jesus, and the desperateness and the need that he had to announce to Jesus, "My daughter's just died. Come lay your hand on her and she will live." Now, I don't know if he believed that or not. We don't know. It doesn't explain that. But this much we know. He had the sense enough to go to Jesus. Because in the midst of his hopelessness was the presence of Jesus Christ in that community. And he went to him. And he said, declared, "If you just lay your hand on her, she'll live." Here was a man of stature that was not important at that time. Here was a man who represented the synagogue, and he had a high position, and that really didn't solve the problem at home, did it? We need to see that this was a desperate man. Out of the tragedy of the death of his son, of his daughter, was ready to look for and do something to get his daughter back from the impossible, from the hopeless. He set aside his position as in the synagogue to go to Jesus. And he comes and noted, what does he do? It says that he worshiped Jesus. He worshiped Jesus. He bowed down to Jesus. He prostrates himself, which, as one of the commentaries mentions, it was the Oriental fashion of the utmost humility. He humbled himself. I tell you, in the midst of hopelessness, we are humbled, aren't we? In the midst of hopelessness, all of the position and all the things that we have and do and all that we figure that our resources are spent and there is nothing else but for us to come and bow down and worship the Lord. Some commentators have written that the ruler came to Jesus as the last resort, but I don't believe that. I think he came recognizing Jesus that had the power to raise his daughter. Listen to his plea again. "But coming," he said, "lay your hand on her and she will raise herself up." This is a word for us this morning, folks, that while everything seems hopeless, while everything is going wrong, we, by going to Jesus to worship him as the Lord of life, and freely declaring that we want what we want, we will receive, gives hope to the hopeless. You see, there's only one that can do that. The Old Testament prayer that could have been known by that man is for us today. And that's from Jeremiah 33:3. He had that. And I'm fully confident that God brought that to him, that Bible verse, that hope, that promise. And what was it? Call unto me, and I will show you great and hidden things. And God does that. It's the joy of God to discover, for us to discover, that in him is hope in the midst of hopelessness. Jesus is our hope for today. Well, we're going to step aside from this ruler, and we'll get to him a bit later again, because there is another hopeless individual here. It's the woman, the suffering woman, truly, truly suffering in so many ways. This is a person that apparently had an incurable health problem. We're told that she suffered for more than 12 long years of an issue of blood. Mark, in his fifth chapter, gives us a little further understanding of what was going on with her. In verse 26 of Mark, the fifth chapter. Well, let me go to 25. And a woman who had a hemorrhage for 12 years and had endured much at the hands of many physicians and had spent all that she had and was not helped at all, but rather had grown worse. Like to the daughter of Jairus, all that they tried to do was in vain. And the condition had worsened for this lady. Worsened in many, many different ways. Her strength she was losing her strength. But worse than that, there was a teaching at the time and the belief, and it really goes back to the Levitical laws of the day. She was declared unclean. She was almost like a leper in her time. She couldn't be around people. This was not permitted. Oh, you ought to read the things in the Levitical laws. It's really tragic to see this. She economically had spent all she had. She had no more. All her resources were gone. She had spent it all trying to solve this health problem. So economically, she was empty. Emotionally, she was affected as the condition drained her strength, and one of the commentators inferred that she was more than likely even divorced by her husband because he couldn't put up with this anymore and he had to separate himself from her. She had to leave him. Terrible. Just a terrible situation. Hopelessness. Unlike the ruler, she couldn't even come to Jesus because she was like a leper. She was not to be in and moving about in society. It's a sad thing. And yet, in the midst of this, was this one ray of hope that she had. What a simple thing, but what a tremendous difference it made in her hopelessness, that if she could just touch the hem of his garment. She couldn't come up in the crowd and appeal like the ruler did, like Jairus did.
but she came around behind. And sort of in the shadow of all that's going on, she very quietly sort of sneaks up and touches the hem of his garment. And it says, Jesus sensed that power had gone out from him. Mark tells us, perceiving in himself that power proceeding from him had gone forth, he turned around. He looked around behind him. This suffering woman of faith had moved her to touch his garment. By faith she did that. Because you see, faith, like James says, without works is dead. Faith in action. The action of touching the garment so that power went out of him and healed this hopeless woman. But you know, there was, I'm sure, a stronger healing that took place that day. It was a healing spiritually. James tells us, as I mentioned, that faith without works is dead, but it is faith that leads to action. Now, if you want to talk about faith, then you put it into action in your life. Not just simply sitting in some sort of isolated situation and looking up with pious eyes and saying, oh God, you're so great, and I really trust you, and so forth. Well, then live it out. And in the midst of hopelessness, God helps us to reach out and to have that power move within our lives. I think it's really something to say that power of Christ went forth from him. And when he had turned and recognized that where she was, he said, daughter, I love that, daughter. That's the second daughter, isn't it? The daughter of Jairus, and now who? The daughter of who? Daughter of Israel. Daughter of God. Daughter. Take courage. Take courage. It's your faith that's made you well. And she was. And she was. I think that she was filled with hope then, don't you? But you see, if she had never made that step, she would never have known. To say I have faith and then not do anything about it, you never know. You have to take that step. It's a faith step. God enables us to do that. There is that time when we can do that. The third hopeless person was the dead daughter. Boy, talk about hopeless, eh? What's she going to do? Can't. She's dead. What could be more graphic as an example than this daughter of the spiritual truth that we can do nothing for ourselves for salvation's sake? It's all of God. Yes, there was the desperate father who went to Jesus and brought him to his dead daughter. It's so interesting that after he declared to Jesus that if you just take her, you can just raise her up. And Jesus, it says, rose and began to follow him. And so did his disciples. Can you imagine that? We don't want to miss this one. We don't want to miss this one. Talk about gawkers. And they followed Jesus to the home of Jairus. And a whole series of things are here that are so interesting in these verses. See Jesus as he comes, empty the house of all of this, wooing and lying and lying and weeping and lying and playing the flutes and playing the harps and all this. Oh, whoa, 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 whoa. And Jesus says that's enough of that. Enough. Please leave. I think he said please, don't you? Leave her alone. She's not dead, she's asleep. Oh, you gotta be kidding me. Did you hear about this? I mean, she's been dead for how long now, and he's coming into here and he's saying she's just asleep. Well, I'm not sure. He took the father and the mother, who by now are believing, because that's what he said to Jesus, the father, and we assume the mother as well. And he took Peter, James, and John, who also believed that he could do it. And then he shut the door. And nothing said. Matthew gives us, he goes right to the point. It says that he entered, took her by the hand, and the girl got up. To the hopeless, Jesus raises up. To the hopeless who find no forgiveness for the awfulness of sin, in the deadness of the lostness, Jesus raises up and gives life. Power goes forth into life of those who are dead. I believe Jesus is coming to us this morning in his word, reaching out to raise us up to eternal life, to put us on a new way. This daughter of Jairus now has life the second time, doesn't she? That's why Jesus said ye must be born again. Being born twice, having the need to only die once. Being resurrected, life eternal. To be alive in Christ. Jesus purposes to come to us this morning through these verses with the hope that he gives us eternal life. You see, God's will expressed, isn't it, that all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. That's God's purpose. That's why Jesus went over there to that home. That's why Jesus responded as he did to the daughter, this poor lady who suffered so badly. Gave her health again, gave her a second life in that sense. And he wants to do that for us today. You know, election's coming up on Tuesday. Oh, he's going to mention that. I don't know how it is with you guys. To me, it's a hopeless situation. That being said, whatever your political view is, I'm not interested in that. Whatever your view is politically, we certainly have a problem, don't we? A hopeless problem, I feel. But it's maybe time for us to look to the Lord. It's maybe our time to come and say, Lord, We are in a nation are in a serious situation. The morality, we read in a Sunday school class about how there is mayhem in the streets, how there is a lack of moral ethic and ethics, how there are so many things that are just polarizing us as a people. I mean, it's not a good scene. Maybe it's time that we all just pause and not pray for one thing or another, just pray that we would see Jesus in the midst of this and that people would see that. Because Jesus met the need of a desperate father. He met the need of a suffering woman. He raised up a dead daughter. He can change a nation. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, as we look to you in the hopelessness of whatever the circumstances, there is hope in you, and I thank you for that. That you sent Jesus into a dying world to give us the hope of second life, to live with you for all eternity. Thank you for these words, Father. Thank you for you, Jesus, for meeting people and living with people and meeting the needs of people, and that we have this in the scriptures to read this morning to give us hope in the midst of so much hopelessness. Thank you, Father. And we look forward to the day when we too shall meet you. Amen. Let us turn to hymn number 526. I think it's really appropriate hymn. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
continue to worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. Praise you also, Father, for all that you have provided, and thank you for the abundant harvest, and we thank you, and also as we place these gifts upon the altar in worship of you and in service to you, may these gifts be used to bring the good news of the gospel to all people. Thank you in Jesus' name. We continue praying this morning, Father, thanking you that we can lift up our petitions to you as we have them before us this morning. We pray, Lord, for Pastor Luke Emerson and the healing process there in his life. We thank you, Father, that it could have been much more serious, and yet we pray for the healing, because there are broken bones and there are bruises, and Lord Jesus, that yet at the same time he is now on the mend. And also for Jennifer. And thank you, Lord, that your angels were really watching over her, like we talked about this week, that you kept her from a more serious injury, and yet we pray for the need for healing for her as well, and for the process to be restored. Thank you for the doctors and medical people that supply. We thank you that Leslie is with us again this morning. Thank you for the healing taking place there. We also continue to pray for others who going through various issues. We think of Bill Martin, and we continue to lift him by name before your throne of grace, and we just guide the doctors in how to treat him as well. And we pray too, Heavenly Father, this morning for Lloyd, who is going to have surgery now next month. We pray that you'd lead and guide and bring him to that point where he will be able to receive that surgery. We pray for Pamela and Matthew and Maggie, and if we lift up to you Norm, and pray for Nikki, healing there for her, and for Mackenzie, healing for her surgery, for James and Matt, for Eunice and Viola. We pray for Ariel and for Holly, for Eric, Pastor Eric. We lift him up to you, Lord, in the treatments that he is receiving. Help him. For Eunice, for Juanita, for Michael and Tim and Ty, we pray for Ty as well today. We pray, Heavenly Father, too, for the counsel and lead and guide. We especially pray for the Norbies as they pray through and seek your will, for the call that they just be willing to do your will in it all. We sense that this was your will to extend the call to him, and so we pray that be confirmed, but we want your will above all things. And pray, thank you for the call committee and thank all that they've done in preparation. We pray for the little ones on the cradle roll, for Isabel and Eva, for Luke and Anna and Elle, and we pray for Brooklyn and Harrison and Isabel, for Emma Lynn, Jackson and Jameson, for Charlotte, for Vivian, and little Alex. Lord, each one of them we lift up to you in Jesus' name. And Lord Jesus, too, would you guide us as a nation as we are moving towards the election day. We want to look to you for your help in the midst of this hopeless situation here. We pray, too, for a word of thanks for all those who have served, and we pray for the upcoming Veterans Day. We thank you for each veteran who has served, and we pray that you just be with them, and especially for many who are dealing with battlefield issues. Would you help them, Jesus? And Lord Jesus, we also this morning want to remember our missionaries, both down in Ecuador, in Mexico, over in Uganda, in India, those that are labor in up in Alaska. Thank you for those who have gone forth and are going forth, and that we pray that we continue to raise up many more workers. These petitions and all else we just include in that perfect prayer you've taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Bow your hearts to the Lord and receive his benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Four, seven, nine. God leads us along. 479.